Check 1, 2, 2, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. there are two things in particular that the child of God has to do in order to make it into heaven. Mark 12, verse 30 says, "And you shall love the Lord with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength." The second in this verse is as follows: "You shall love your neighbor as yourself." These are cases of what love is.
Oh, there we go. Okay. All right. She also holds a master's degree in marriage and family therapy from North Central University with certifications in trauma and suicide prevention. She has served the church in different conferences in various capacities for over 15 years. Now, as children of God, we all desire to make it into heaven, but sometimes our selfish ways slow us down on the journey. We tend to see the wrong in situations that we are not a part of and fail to see our own selfish acts. I think we should all ask ourselves this question: are we doing all we can to keep God's commands and make it into heaven? That is loving God with all our hearts and loving our neighbors as God loves us. We will witness a series of cases under the banner of Love Is. Let us now tune in to hear the opening statements.
All right, so we went to the activity before, right? Sorry, so 1, 2, 3. Lean forward, lean backward, to the left, to the right. Stand up, sit down, to the left, to the right. Lean forward, lean backward, to the left, to the right. Stand up, sit down, to the left, to the right. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love. Love is. Love is every patient deed.
It is every kind word meeting every need.
Love is never boastful or proud.
It keeps no memory of yesterday's wrongs.
But is ever ready to let forgiveness prolong.
Love is protective, selfless, and mild.
Just like a mother's love for her child.
Love always hopes, perseveres, and trusts.
It is truthful, honoring, and just.
Love is unfailing. Love is united. It is what brings us here. Yes, in love, we welcome you.
So, in court today, we have a member of the ACF SDA Church who has brought her neighbor to court for continuously picking the fruits off her tree without consent. Now, considering that most of the tree is on his side of the fence, she is asking the court to either send him to jail or let him pay a huge fine.
Docket number 0219, Love Is versus Cruelty.
Since the defendant moved in roughly 5 years ago, he has been picking fruits off my client's tree. This has been happening every week while the fruit is in season. Even with repeated requests for him to stop, the problem persists. I would like to call Jodi Ann to the stand.
Witnesses, do you swear to the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. Today's scripture reading will be taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 to 7. Please stand. I will read in your hearing. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes. Love always preserves. Please be seated.
Based on your knowledge of love, is it being properly expressed here?
I was just a child, acting demons here to leave. That what he had me be is who I am. Hundreds of times I have spent my days believing that what he had me be is who I am. As I come to see the weaker side of me, realize his grace is what I'll need. When sin demanded justice for my soul, mercy said, no, I'm not gonna let you go. Jesus, mercy said no. For God to love the world that he sent his son to save us. From the cross he built a bridge to set us free. Oh, but deep within our hearts there is still war that rages, that makes a sacrifice so hard to see. As midnight fell on crucifixion day, the light of hope seemed oh so far away. As evil tried to stop redemption, I'm not gonna let you go. I'm
The prosecutor makes a compelling case for my client's guilt and made a bold choice by calling my defendant as a witness. But I would like to present to the court that the branches my client has been picking from are the ones that hang over her side of the fence. Now, my client has been put in a very difficult position of closing her business due to the medical bills piling up of her ailing husband, and there is no money for home care. It has gotten to the point where she had to send her two small children to live with family. Now, the fruit bearing on that tree made her so happy because she could find a way to make an honest living, and maybe once a week, she would be able to sell enough to get a decent husband, or a decent meal for her husband. Now, as a self-proclaimed child of God, she believed that her neighbor would not have any issue with her picking the fruit from the hanging tree.
As children of God desiring to make it into heaven, we are ordered to live our lives according to Mark 12, verse 31. The second is this: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other greater commandment than these. An example of how we can do this can be found in Proverbs 19, verse 17. Whoever is kind to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will reward them for what they have done.
Your Honor, I would like to call my first witness to the stand. UF? Now, we were sent here to love our neighbors as ourselves. What are your thoughts on this situation?
I would explain love as I know it this way.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again.
Amazing love.
Amazing love. How can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do.
I'm forgiven.
live. Wow. That was an emotional roller coaster of a case, wasn't it? Well, we are going to take a 10-minute recess while we await the next case to be called, all right?
Children of the world, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. Good morning and happy Sabbath, boys and girls. So, I have a story, or more like a scenario, that I want to present to you guys. So, how many of you help with vacuuming around the house? Just show of hands. Okay. So for those of you who have vacuumed or watched your parents do it, I'm gonna give you the scenario and let me know if you've seen or done this before. So, you're going along vacuuming the floor and you see a large piece of lint or something on the floor. You run the vacuum over it and pull it back, and the lint is still there. You stop, because it shouldn't be there. You run the vacuum over it again, and it's still there. You try it again, and it's still there. So what do? You put the vacuum in the upright position, you pick up the lint, you look at it, and then you set it back down on the floor so you can try it again. It's kind of silly, isn't it? See, you picked it up in your hands, and common sense would tell you, maybe I should throw away this piece of trash into the trash can. But no, you gave the vacuum a second chance. Sometimes it lets you down, even after you've lent it a hand. But other times, that little bit of movement is just what the vacuum needs to suck up that piece of lint. In a funny way, this little scenario reminds me of how God is with us. God puts people into our lives so we can share the gospel with them through our words and our deeds. But we walk on by and we don't do anything. But God gives us another shot. But then we let them down again, and again, and again. So God steps in and gives them, or us, a nudge, so we can have a second chance. It must drive God nuts sometimes, the way we keep missing the moments He gives us. If it does, He doesn't show it. He just keeps giving us another chance. That's why we know we're not perfect, but God is, and that's why He died, to pay the price for our sins. And that's why He still gives us second chances. It's embarrassing to think of all the times you might have failed Him, but we can take comfort in knowing this, that God will never, ever give up on us. So, as long as you're willing to follow Him, He will always be willing to give you a second chance. Would any of you guys like to pray? No? You like to pray? Okay. Bow your heads and close your eyes.
Pray.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Mommy. Yeah.
Benny, Mommy. Bless Mommy. Bless Mommy. Bless Daddy. Thank you for bringing us to church today. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You guys may now return to your seats. Thank you. All the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
Hello, good afternoon, church. I have the announcements for this evening. Tomorrow at 12, we will be volunteering with South Outreach. The address is 808 West Central Florida Boulevard. And yeah, we'll be volunteering with the South Outreach Homeless Ministries. After service, there'll be lunch. And then right after lunch, we'll have an AY service. And we'll finish the evening off with a movie night.
Okay, and we just have some MOH announcements for you guys this morning as well. Next week, we have a family meeting at 2 p.m. We also have a team game night at 7 p.m. For more information, you can visit our website, mohsda.org. We also are currently doing a sleeping bag outreach ministry. So if you have any bags to donate or you want to donate funds to help us get some supplies to give to our unsheltered friends, we would greatly appreciate that. And also to stay updated with everything that we do, our ministries, and just to get information on when our church services are, you can text the letters MOH to 84576. And you can also follow us on social media at message_SDA on Instagram and Twitter, and Facebook, Message of Hope SDA Community Mission. And that's all the announcements we have for this morning.
Hello, everyone's hearing me?
Yes.
Hello. Happy Sabbath, everyone. We're now going to have our intercessory prayer. So I'm asking if you're able to kneel, you'll kneel. And we're going to go before God in prayer. Okay? Dear kind and righteous Father, we come before you today on your holy Sabbath day, Lord, to give you praise and to worship you for bringing us to another week. Lord, as we're here reflecting on love, dear Lord, we know that you are love, Heavenly Father. And I pray that you may accept your worship, Father, cleanse us of all our sins and all our filthiness, that our worship may be acceptable to you. Dear Lord, we give this program to you, the remainder of it, dear Lord, and we ask for your Holy Spirit to be here and be with every heart. Heavenly Father, there may be people here who are struggling, whether financially, in their family, Lord Jesus. A lot of students, they are so stressed out with school, dear Lord. A lot of our friends who, Father God, they are struggling with mental issues, Lord. I pray for them, dear Lord. We bring them before you. Lord, it's not that you do not know them, Father, but you ask us to pray, to pray for other people, to bring other people before you. And Lord, that is what we're doing here tonight. Father. Thank you for MOH for opening up their doors to us. Thank you, Lord, for the young people who are here on this your Holy Sabbath day. They could be anywhere else, but they are here to worship you and to give you thanks. Lord, I ask and I pray, dear Lord, that you will intervene in anyone who have a special prayer request in their hearts, dear Lord, as they're praying now to you. Father God, I pray that you may hear their hearts, oh Lord, and grant them their desire. Lord, I pray that for the remaining of the service, that we will learn something new about you, dear Heavenly Father, and we will want to be drawn closer to you, Heavenly Father, as we learn more about love and why you love us so much, dear Heavenly Father. Help us to love you just as much. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this hot Sabbath day, and I pray that we will enjoy the rest of it. We invite your Holy Spirit one more time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Happy Sabbath, in person and virtual family. So, as you can see, it's offering time, but I want to prep you for this. And so I'd like to give a scenario, and I want you to respond accordingly. The scenario is simple. You were broke this week. You decided to check your bank account, and for whatever reason, there was $1 million deposit in your account. So now when I say it's offering time, I want you to respond in that scenario, okay? All right, guys. It's offering time. in this Love Is weekend, I think it's interesting when we look at the love languages, although it wasn't set from a biblical side. One of the love languages is giving, the giving of gifts particularly. And as we look at offering time, we look at the gifts that we have been given, that we are allowed to give back to God and give unto others. And I just would like to highlight very quickly that one thing that MOH has been doing with the gifts that we have been given to God is actually reaching out to our community with the backpack drive. Recently, in this past month, I think we've given 200 sleeping bags, food, water, and conversations with some of the less fortunate than us. And so we're being very intentional about serving with the gifts that God has given us. And so if you'd like to participate in that, I would encourage you to donate through your tithes and offering through Cash App at $MOHSDAFL. That's $MOHSDAFL. And as well, you can donate through our online giving at mohsda.org/giving. That is mohsda.org/giving. God loves a cheerful giver, and we at MOH in our serving and growing together are going to make sure that not only we are cheerful givers, but that we're good stewards of those gifts. Let us pray. God, our Father in heaven, it is but a blessing to recognize that you have bestowed onto us something that is a need. And because of that, God, we give gifts onto you, gifts that say, God, you are a good God. God, you're sustaining God. God, you're healing God. God, you're forgiving God. And God, we thank you that we can acknowledge you in that. And so, Father God, I ask that you give this church wisdom, that you give the college students and everybody who's joining this worship service a good gift so they can steward onto themselves as well into their community. We ask that you continue to confirm the works of our hands and that we can go for it as cheerful givers in your mighty name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Live. Welcome back to the MOH Court of Love. The first case has gone into deliberation, and we now turn our attention to a case involving adultery. She is ready.
So, in court today, we have a married couple who are members of the ACF SDA Church. Now, the husband is accusing his wife of cheating twice, and he wants the divorce. He also wants the court to also order her to pay alimony.
Docket number 1922, Love Is versus Adultery.
My client did not come to court today on mere suspicions. He had the unfortunate opportunity to have caught his wife cheating. After 20 years of marriage, initially marrying at 21 and 20 respectively, he has managed to stay faithful throughout the entirety of their union, while his wife has cheated not once, but twice during their time together. He feels justified in his decision here today, as the Bible has given us permission to seek divorce once there has been adultery. After this many years together, two beautiful children, and more than enough money in their accounts, he would just like to be allowed to go on his way with adequate compensation, and if possible, an explanation. At this time, I would like to call Alicienne to the stand. I know this is a difficult situation, but do you have any advice on how love could be better expressed between the couple here today?
Looking at the story here, my advice is... I see shattered, you see whole. I see broken, but you see beautiful. And you're helping me to believe. You're restoring me piece by piece. It's nothing to do.
Purified, I'm clean.
Now, I must give the prosecutor props. If I were the jury, I would definitely be thinking one way right now. But before you make your judgments, let's remember that there are two sides to every story. For the past 10 years, Mrs. Joseph has felt like an unimportant part of her husband's life. He has found every reason and found every priority outside of the home. It has gotten to the point where they don't even have time for their family worships in mornings and evenings anymore. After he got his promotion at work, he spends all his time there. And when he's not there, he's at church or some urgent meeting that just came up at the church. Now, my client has explained, as her explanation to her husband, that the one thing she really wanted, even though they have a lot of money in the account and two beautiful kids, was the companionship that marriage was supposed to offer. The young man who had taken his place came at a time when she was at her weakest. And after ending the affair the first time and realizing no change in her husband's attitude towards her, she went back to where she felt needed.
Now, we are by no means claiming that a Christian marriage is easy. It should be one of the purest forms of love. But remember to keep God's words at the center of it, two of which are Matthew 18, verses 21 and 22. Then Peter came up and said to him, "Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me, and how will I forgive him? As many as seven times?" And Jesus said to him, "I do not say to you seven times, but 70 times seven." And Ephesians 5, verse 25 says, "Husbands, love your wives just as God loved the church and gave himself up for her."
Love is the more excellent way we'll take the witness stand to explain the true meaning of love.
And we're live. This is one verdict that I'll be on the edge of my seat to hear. It's hard to know how to react in a situation such as the one presented on both sides of the court. Don't go just yet. Let's hear what the judge has to say about what love is.
Before we hear from the judge, we'll have one more song from UF.
Oh, Is it on? Okay. There we go. Good morning, good afternoon now, MOH and ACF, UF. Listen. We're not gonna start this. Oh, the illustrious. Oh my gosh. I was just at FAM two weeks ago and I had to hear the highest on how many hills? So we're gonna say happy Sabbath to UF, FSU, UCF, USF. Who we missing? Who? Oh, we got Bethune in here. We got Bethune in the house. Happy Sabbath. This is good to see you guys all here together for our collegiate day. We got to do this more often. Okay? It's really good to see you guys. You know, I work with youth ministries, and all the time we're hearing about all the things young people aren't doing, and we don't spend enough time showing what young people are doing. And so, I'm loving the band right here. Man, why y'all ain't tell me? I would have brought my stuff. Hey, man, listen, for real. Next time, I'm going to bring my, you're right? But put me in the back, though, way in the back. All right. But it is good to be with you guys this morning. So watch this. All right. So I came in prepared, right? I came in with a word and everything. I came in with a sermon, and we're not going to do that today. The Holy Spirit said, now we're not going to do that today, because I've been hearing so much about love. I've been hearing about this virtue called love. And so we're going to explore what love says from the Word of God, because Valentine's Day just passed. Hey, you broke, man. She got you for your pockets. Oh man, Valentine's Day just passed, February 14th. And then the camera's on. Cuz you know, we it's February 14th, you find out who the side chicks are. You know. So we're going to celebrate the 14th, and I heard the 15th. Did we add the 15th in there too? But it's during that time that you hear so much about love, and then we view love through the lenses of the world. And so now I'm like, okay, so what does love really mean? You know, I grew up all my life hearing about love. Tina Turner said, "Well, what love got to do with it?" She had a couple black eyes and things, but you know, we, you know, Chris Brown and Justin Bieber. And Avant, I'm showing my age here, and Joe and Genuine, and I'm showing my age. I don't know y'all got who y'all got? August, yeah, is that him? Yeah, that's y'all stuff. You know what I mean? I had what's his name that's in jail? I don't want to say his name, but we're not. You know? Yeah, listen, y'all know who I'm talking about. Yeah, I know, Mr. Kelly. Y'all know what I'm talking about. But that's the definition of love when I was coming up. But the love that they spoke about is always about a possessive kind of love. And so we want to look at love through what the Word of God has to say about love. Okay? I know we sing a lot of times, "I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God." And we look at some people and I'm like, "Lord Jesus, I'm so surprised you're a part of the family of God." Let's pray before we begin. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we're asking you to come and tabernacle with us. Father, I'm asking you that you illuminate the word love. Father, you said that you are love. Show us. In Jesus' name, amen. So I said we're gonna do something different. We're trying to find out love. A minute. So what does love really mean? What do we mean? What do you mean when you say you love somebody? Right? And so we're going to go to the Word of God to try to extrapolate what does love mean? What is love? And I know we read, what is it? 1 Corinthians, what we call that? What we call that? The love chapter, right? There we go. Okay, so actually we're going to look at, I need somebody to open up their Bibles for me, and I want you to read, Matthew 22, 37 to 39. I know y'all been in books all week, y'all college students. Y'all been reading all week, right? Oh, y'all gonna read today too. Matthew 22, 30, go ahead, what'd it say? Uh-huh. Go ahead and read 40. Okay, it says that you shall love the Lord your God with all your what? All your what? And what? So check this out. The disciples came to Jesus and asked him, what was the greatest commandment? So picture this. If I were a God-fearing Jew. Now remember, understand the Jewish nation. They lived their lives according to what? The law. They lived their lives according to the law. So everything that they did was dictated by law. So here I am with the man himself, Jesus, the fulfillment of the promise. And I'm with him. That's my dude. I'm doing ministry with him because, you see, I'm trying to see if I could get myself into the kingdom, you know. People like me, we got to stay close to the Lord. I wish we would have salvation by works a little bit sometime. I'm trying to make it in. And so the disciple says, what's the greatest commandment? And I am a good Jew. And then you're going to tell me that the greatest commandment is loving the Lord, the God, with all your heart. Okay. And then he has a conjunction. And what's the conjunction there? He said, and I'm thinking he's going to say, and keep the Sabbath holy. I could do that easy. I'm like, oh, I'm in there. He said, loving the Lord, because if you look at the commandments, it says, what's the first one? No, we ain't talking about that, the real Ten Commandments. Thou shalt, huh? Thou shalt not have any other gods before me. The second one. You can't be making up stuff now. What was that in Negro relations? You shall not what? You were right. Don't call the Lord's name in vain. And was the third one? And the second one, no graven images. And don't call the Lord's name in vain, right? So when Jesus answered and said that the greatest commandment is loving the Lord with all your heart, he was pretty much saying the first three, if you look at the Ten Commandments and how it is structured, the first three commandments literally is loving the Lord with what? All your heart. So I'm like, okay, I got that. And then he says, and then when you love the Lord with all your heart, what you got to do? All of that, soul, mind, body, because all of that is included. And that conjunction is what? And then what you got to do after that? Oh, y'all don't even want to say it now because y'all don't like y'all neighbor? Love your neighbor as yourself. Now, we said the first three commandments, loving the Lord. Then we have the fourth commandment right there that talks about what? Remember the Sabbath day. How you remember the Sabbath day? Keeping holy. How you keep holy? All of that. Thou not who? Thou nor your sons. All right. All right. Now, after that, What is the last six of the commandments? You say louder. People. People. So in essence, when you love the Lord with all your heart and all your soul, it is manifested by what? How you treat people. We got a whole lot of Christians running around here talking about they love the Lord and they don't like people. You can't love the Lord and you don't like people. You can't. We got six, the last six commandments. How we treat each other. I would have been mad if that was the answer that God gave, that Jesus said to me. Because I'm like, wait a minute now. Let's talk about the Sabbath. I don't want to talk about people. You know? Let's talk about diet. Lord, you know I don't eat meat. I be seeing them seafood boils on. Y'all be watching them mukbangs? Y'all ever watch? Y'all be watching it? Y'all be seeing them crab legs? Ooh! You, I'm like, I ain't gonna eat the, I can eat the corn though. I can lick the corn. Them seasonings. I'm like, oh. Girl. And I'm saying to myself, why can't we talk about that? Why can't my salvation be dependent on that? You know how we are. We love to tell people what we eat and what we don't eat. As if our diet is salvific. Guess what? Them impossible burgers are impossible to save you. And then and I'll be watching. Listen, they have a drumstick made out of kale. The disrespect. And then the disclaimer, it tastes just like chicken. No, don't. Or cauliflower buffalo wings. How? And we think we're better than people because that's what we eat. You see what I'm saying? We think that we're better than other people because we don't eat like that. And God, Jesus is saying, love your neighbor as yourself. You got to understand the children of Israel thought that they were better than everybody else. The children of Israel thought that they were the apple of God's eye. The children of Israel thought that because they didn't do this and they didn't do that on the Sabbath, that it gave them entrance into the kingdom. So they thought that they can do instead of be. And is the camera's on? I just wish that we could still enter into the kingdom by doing. Because it is so much harder to be. They thought that the Samaritans were dogs. And so when Jesus answered the disciples and said to love your neighbor as yourself, you got to understand how disgusting that they were appalled. Like, wait a minute, what? You mean to tell me as a slave, I got to view the slave master as a brother in Christ? You mean to tell me as a rape survivor, I got to see my assailant as a brother in Christ? Love my neighbor as myself. But when you love the Lord the way that he needs you to love him, that stuff flows right up off of you. It is God that gives you. Because I can't do it by myself. I'm still mad at people from what year we in? Girl. I'm still mad at people from the 90s. I'm showing my age. And God is, you know, you have some people that you, when it comes to love, they want to tell you how you're supposed to be loved. Like my husband, you know, when we first started, we've been together for a long time. Oh, Jesus, a long time. Were you in? And he used to bring me flowers. Yeah, I'm from Brooklyn. Bring me some wings. bring me a six piece. He used to bring me flowers. And so I appreciated it. And then as we got deeper into our relationship and as we got closer to each other, and I'm like, well, you know what? I appreciate the flowers, but I don't want no flowers. I don't really like flowers. Now, if he would have kept on bringing me flowers, girl, after I told you I don't want no flowers, would that be a demonstration of his love to me? Do we do that with God? God keeps saying, love me. You got to love me. And this is how I want you to love me. But we keep, God is asking us for apples, and we keep bringing him oranges, and we wonder why our lives are such a mess. God himself is the embodiment and the personification of love. So what is love? And understanding the importance of love. Every thought, love then is not a gray area in scripture. Jesus gave love priority over all other Christian virtues. Every thought, response, and act of goodwill must first pass through the fine filter of love, or it doesn't mean anything. We read 1 Corinthians 13, that though I give my body to be burned, not me though, I'm black enough. You know what I mean? Though I give my goods to feed the poor, we got people like that. All of the things that we're doing. And then he says, it says, though I understand all prophecy. You know we are people of prophecy now. Listen, my auntie had a dream. I was like, auntie, I am not pregnant. I don't care if you dreamt fish. You know how that be. I'm talking to somebody. Oh, I dreamt the fish. I dreamt a snake. Don't nobody dream that I'm going to be a millionaire or no money. It's always something crazy. You know? It says, though we understand all prophecy and all mystery, and as Adventists, we believe that we are a prophetic people. We believe that we have the very gift of prophecy. And the Bible says that even though you have that and you have no love, it means nothing. You and your prophecy both raggedy. I done seen some raggedy prophecy. Raggedy! Because here we are telling people all of the things that we do and we don't do, and we have no love. He said, we sound like, I remember my son, one of them was learning how to play the drums. I don't know if you ever heard somebody try to practice the drums. I'm like, we need to find you another instrument. You know, the piano, I could deal with people that can't play the piano because the succession of keys kind of, you know, you can kind of... The drums? Hoo-wee. I said, ah, baby, maybe this ain't your gift. let's try the flute. Oh, but that's what the Bible says. It's just noise, emptiness. It profits us nothing. And guess where we're going with our raggedy love and our raggedy prophecy and our raggedy deeds? Straight to hell. I said it. You're going to hell. We have no love. And you can't get love until you have the Father. You got to love the Lord with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind and all your body and all of that. The Bible says that in Matthew, seek ye first what? The kingdom of God. And watch this. If you're not seeking God first, chances are you're not seeking him at all. You're not seeking him at all. And because love is the very thing that God is, we ought to go to God to find out what love is. What love is. So one of the attributes of love, one of the attributes of love in demonstrating the virtue of love, because you can't say you love somebody and you can't, and you don't show them, right? How can we practice the virtue of love? Love values people. Love values people. And it saddened me. It saddened me in this temperature that we're in this environment that we're in our nation and in our country, right? Where I have never seen such ugliness and meanness before. Not from the world, but from people who claim to be Christians. From people who claim to love God, right? So the thing about Christianity is this. Okay, so when I was in the military, we traveled all over the world, right? We traveled, I was all over the place. And so we were overseas somewhere, and we were allies. Depending on where you go, certain nations, you can't wear certain things. But when you're home, you know, with friends, you can kind of let your hair down. So at that time, we were wearing a particular patch that identified who we were. Now, it didn't tell us exactly what your job was. It didn't tell you. It just said that you belonged to a certain group. So when people saw you, there was, you're like, okay, I know who they are, right? And so we got stuck somewhere. We were driving and we got stuck. And so another group of people, now they were a different culture. And because they saw the patch, they stopped. Because the patch identified that we were friends. We were friends. So when they saw that, look, them other people, now I don't know if they was on their way to rob somebody, but because they saw the patch, at least they weren't going to rob us because we were friends. Now, as Christians, we say that we love God, and yet still here we are being as disgusting and mean and nasty to each other. We are upset, and we allow the devil to divide us based on politics. Politics. Here we are. Remember, we love to say that the church and state are separate. Here we are. We call ourselves a people of God, called out from the world. Yet still, we are getting our information and news from people that don't love God. And we're using that information to demonize other Christians. We're using that information to demonize other cultures. We're using that information to demonize people. Here we are talking about should people, certain people, be given rights. What kind of religion are we practicing? That's not love. If it has a soul, it's worth saving. Since then, since when did we become so mean? Since when did we become so nasty? And like the Bible says, our righteousness is like filthy rags. That's not love. That is not love. So we have to examine our love according to what Jesus says. If you love me, this is what you will do. If you love me, listen, he didn't say that people, we ought to give people things and love people based on their accomplishments. We don't love people whether they're straight or gay. We don't love people whether they're married or single. We love people because they are human. People don't need a prerequisite to be treated with eccentric value and love. Their humanity should suffice. Period. Period. We are valuable because God made us valuable. We're talking about what love is. Love values other people. Love values other people. So examine your love to people. Is their value dependent on what they can do for you? Is their value dependent on what they are to you? Is their value dependent on what, how you feel when you're around them? Love values people for being people and being made in the image of a mighty God. Number two, love is vulnerable to the other person. In other words, love opens up its life to another person. I know a lot of people that say, it's hard to love because they don't want to get hurt. And we have been hurt by love, but that's the thing. I might get hurt. You might not. When you don't allow yourself to be vulnerable, you miss out on the very essence of love. And it's usually the ones that are closest to us that hurt us the most. But that is what love is. Jesus himself left heaven. And he left co-eternal, being a co-eternal with the Son, with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Co-eternal dominion to come here. I wonder what that conversation was like. Like, who gonna do it? You know what I mean? Like, who, wait a minute. Who's gonna go down and save people who don't want to be saved? Save people that are gonna treat you bad. Save people that are gonna nail you to the cross. Endure all of those things. Who's gonna do it? And he said, I will. Who? The sign-up sheet would have been right there, and that's what love does. He became vulnerable. He took off divinity and put on humanity, and he suffered, became vulnerable because of love. That's what love does. So if you've never endured anything, have you really loved? And I'm talking about enduring where you even put aside your own well-being for somebody else. That's what love does. Love becomes vulnerable. I didn't say that love becomes stupid. Because we time to think that you fall in love, you know what I'm saying? Love made me do that. No, love, girl, love did not make you let that man cheat on you all the time. That's not love. It's stupid. But that's another sermon for another day. All right? That's not love. That's what the world wants us to believe that love is. That's not love. Love is we tend to think that love is just a feeling. Love is an intentional, deliberate choice. It is. It's a choice. And we have to, as Christians, we have to choose love every day. And every time we have to choose love. Not love doesn't mean that you just let people just run all over you. That, once again, that ain't love. You're being foolish now. That's not love. Because sometimes people like the idea of being a victim. They like the idea of being a martyr. Love is pure and intentions are honest and honorable. Love wants to see the best in other people and to be other people to be the best. Because at the end of love, I want to show you the Father. We're ambassadors of love itself, God. God is love. And that's what we are, ambassadors of love. Sometimes we just speaking with our flesh. That's not love. Trust me, that is not love. You think it's love. Now you got five kids. You couldn't feed the first two. That is not love. What you really need is, I'm on camera. That's not love. And we need to stop allowing the world to tell us what love is and go to the Word of God to find out what love really is. Love is vulnerable. Love is vulnerable. Jesus himself did the most vulnerable thing. He allowed his heart to be broken by people he came to save. Hung on a cross, disrespected, humiliated for love. C.S. Lewis says, to love is to be vulnerable. Love anything and your heart will certainly be wrung and possibly broken. If you want to make sure of keeping it intact, you must give your heart to no one, not even to an animal. Wrap it carefully around with hobbies and little luxuries. Avoid all entanglements. I don't think he meant like Jada entanglement, but lock it up safe in a casket or coffin of your selfishness. But in that casket, safe, dark, motionless, earless, it will change. It won't be broken. Instead, it will become unbreakable, impenetrable, and irredeemable. That's death as a human. That's death as a human. The last point I want to bring before I close is, I hear all the time, love don't cost a thing. Yes, it does. Love costs. Love costs. Love gets dirty. Love takes chances. The Bible says that how many times I got to forgive people? Me? One and done with me. You are one and done with me. You hear me? You got but one. And here's the thing. Because we've been hurt so many times, we approach people and we're so defensive that we won't even allow ourselves to be loved. So we approach people and we're already suspicious of them. Love costs. It takes chances. It says, how many times I got to forgive? Who math majors in here? Who here? Girl. Oh, y'all don't. Oh, y'all wrong for that. That's a lot of times to allow people to give you chances. But I'm so happy that we serve a God, not of a first chance, but we serve a God of a second chance and a God of a third chance and a God of a... That's the kind of God we serve. Because Lord knows, if I was God, I would have been through with me. I'd be the only one in hell. Because my probation would have closed like in the 2000 something. He'd be like, you know what? Just get your stuff. Get your stuff. But I'm so glad that I serve a God of so many chances. And he's given me an opportunity to get it right. Play something for me. And God has given you an opportunity to get it right because of love. That's what love does. Love holds on. It doesn't keep a record of wrongdoing. I do. Pray for me. It forgives fast and it forgives often. It's not envious. It's not boastful. It's not prideful. Love is not immodest. See, the thing is with modesty, we tend to think of modesty as a gendered thing. Only women can be immodest. But the reality is modesty just brings bringing attention to oneself. Love doesn't do that. Love puts other people in front. Examine your relationships. Examine how you love. Are you loving as God wants you to love? My last point is love is unconditional. It's unconditional. There's a story that says that there were missionaries who were giving out medicine in a certain village. Sooner or later, because they ended up bringing more medication to more parts of the village or the countryside, the more primitive people did not have to walk so far to the missionary outposts. But But every week, the people would walk to the missionary outposts and the hospitals and the clinics that were closer. They bypassed and they made that long trek. One of the missionaries said, you know, they give the medication closer to your village. The villagers said, we know. The medicine is the same, but the hands are different. The medicine is the same, but the hands are different. Love is unconditional. Jesus himself said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. He said, say all the light-skinned people. Did it say that? He said all the white people. All the Asians. Did it say that? Oh, it says all the straight people. It says whosoever believes should not perish. See, y'all don't understand. Whosoever, because you know who's whosoever? Me, I'm whosoever. Should not perish but have everlasting life. That's what love does. Love saves. Love sees the value in you when other people say that you're not valuable. Love sees your worth even when other people fail to see how worthy you are. Because you got to understand, your worth is not incumbent on what you do. In English, that means there is nothing that we can do to be less worthy. Did y'all catch that? You can't lose your worth. You can't lose your value. It's immutable. That's what Jesus did. He made your value immutable. So those people who tell you that you're not worthy of love, the people who tell you that you're not worthy of value, that you have no worth, you can't listen to them. Because God made you valuable and he made you worthy. And there's nothing that you can do to change that. And there's nothing you can do to make God love you less. Yeah, you can come to church every Sabbath or not come at all. He's not gonna love you any less because there's nothing that you did to make him love you in the first place. That's love. And over 2,000 years ago, Jesus made the ultimate sacrifice of love. Greater love hath no man than this, than he laid down his life for me and for you in the most horrific way. That's love. Somebody here wants to say, Lord, I haven't been loving you well. I've been allowing the world and I've been getting other things between me and my love for you and your love for me. Or I had it all wrong. I thought that I had to do things to gain your love. And he's saying, you ain't got to do that. I loved you with an everlasting love. Lord, I did this and I did that. And there's so many things that I did and I thought that you not talking to me. He's like, you ain't think I know all of that stuff? I'm God. I kind of know everything. I know that. And he's telling you that I still love you. And I'm waiting for you to reconcile that relationship with me. Because I love you with an everlasting love. Somebody wants to stand today and declare that they want to love God better. They want to understand his everlasting love. And they want to know what it is that I have to do to renew my relationship with God. I want you to stand with me. I want to pray for you and with you today. God is love. And God loves us, each and every one of us. He says, you're going to know mine. My people, you're going to know mine. If you see my boys, one of the reasons that you know my boys are my boys, they all have a chin cleft. Yeah. all of them have a cleft. You know that Superman dimple in that chin? Oh, them like, yeah, them the Madrid boys. And God is saying that you're going to know mine. You're going to know my children. Not by the texture of their hair. Not by the color of their skin. Not by their language or their culture. You're going to know mine by their love. Let us show the world whose we are by our love. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for being a loving God, a good God, a merciful God. Father, we thank you for being the God of a second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth chance, Father. Lord, there's so many things that you could have given up on us for. So many things, Father. But you continue to love us. Father, help us to abide in our love. Father, there are so many students here. They are experiencing so many trials and tribulations, and I'm asking you to shower them with your love, your grace, and your mercy. Forgive their sins. Bless us, Father. And ultimately, we know that your love wants to save us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. y'all. Hello, hello, hello. Hello, hello. Hello. Hello, hello, hello.
Hello. What's going on, guys? How you guys doing? That was an awesome song, wasn't it? And man, I ain't never seen a judge like speak like that. I need to go to court more often, you know what I'm saying? Wait, we're live? Oh, sorry. I'm standing in the deliberation with the jury as they discuss the verdicts and possible punishments for our defendants. Things seem to be going in a different direction as they discuss the importance of a mediator under the topic Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant.
Okay, so this is unorthodox as we are having Sabbath school at the end of the program, but this is where you guys get to talk, right? You know, in real life, when they call up citizens to help the jury make the decision, right? So you heard all three cases, all three witnesses. So now we're here to make the verdict, and we as the jury would like your help. All right, so the Sabbath school lesson is called Jesus the Mediator, the New Covenant. So does anybody know what the New Covenant is that they're talking about? Was there an old covenant for there to be a new covenant? What is it? Did you again also answer yes? So you guys didn't learn anything from the Honorable Dr. Lex?
Well, we know that in the Old Testament and before Jesus came, that God met with Moses and he made a covenant with the children of Israel at Mount Sinai, and that was what was referred to as the Old Covenant. And in that covenant, they were asked to do certain things that God asked of them to keep the covenant, and God would keep his side of the covenant, which was a promise made to them of salvation.
Okay, wonderful. Anybody want to talk about the new one?
Okay, so the new covenant, well, we talked about the old covenant being a bilateral covenant where there were stipulations that needed to be made in order for the other party to comply, for the entire covenant to be made. Whereas the new covenant makes the old covenant obsolete, right? This is Jesus as the fulfillment of all of that they had to do. For the old covenant, they had priestly mediators, man mediators, and now they have Jesus. That's currently our mediator instead of the older priest, or the man, the human priest.
Perfect, yes. So by living a perfect life, and then by dying in our place, as we heard in this sermon, Jesus mediated a new, better covenant between us and God. And through his death, Jesus canceled the penalty of debt that our trespasses demanded and made it possible for the new covenant. So it's just like what Dr. Lex was saying. There is nothing we can do to get salvation because Jesus is our surety. Anybody want to add anything?
And one thing I appreciate with the lesson that it brings out is that we hear the term new covenant and we begin to think that something was destroyed, something was removed, and the lesson does a really good job in looking at the language and the process about which it happens to assure us that God didn't change something, right? And that's very important because we hear the words Old and New Testament, and there's people who say Old Testament Christians and New Testament Christians, and there's things that you do, and it gets really complicated in thinking that God changed his mind. And I think we'll go into this a little bit further, but I just wanted to highlight that because it's really brought out really well in the lesson.
Okay, yes. So it can be argued, as he was pointing out, that the covenant is not really new, but a renewal of the original covenant, right? So the issue with the old covenant, which was, as our panelists talked about, Moses, the Ten Commandments, and them having the sacrificial ceremonies. So in Leviticus, we know that there are animal sacrifices that were done, and you have the priests that went in and mediated for the people. But this was all a shadow of what Jesus was going to do, right? So the problem with the old covenant was that it was broken, right? The covenant was not faulty. It was the people that were faulty. So if Israel had seen through the symbols to the coming Messiah and put their faith in him, the covenant would not have been broken. So we wouldn't have this new covenant, right? Yet to be fair, there were many believers throughout Israelite history to whom the purposes of the covenant were fulfilled and who had the laws in their heart. So as we go through the lesson, we're going to see that this new covenant first was put on tablets of stone, but then Jesus came to put it in our hearts. Any comments?
So on the line that you said, the covenant wasn't faulty, the people were. So when I think about a new covenant, it can almost give an idea that the people now aren't faulty. And I'm just going off of that one line. So it's like, wait a minute. So what was the point of God really doing the first covenant? You know, like what's God's whole deal anyway? And as the judge talked about love, you know, Exodus 25, right? He's 8, I think. He says, let's make a sanctuary so I could dwell among them. Like, this whole thing has always been about nearness and proximity and closeness. Like, I just want to be where you at, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's always what it's been about. So when I think about that line about the people not being faulty and stuff, or the people were faulty, I think today I'm still faulty. And I think what God did was he said, let me just make it a little easier for you. Because I know you're not, I just know, I can see it. So I'm going to just do everything that I can do possible so that it has nothing to do with you. It's all about me. And that's kind of hard to sit in sometimes, you know? But yeah.
All right, so I want to elaborate on the part that he talked about, why did God create the law in the first place, right? Since as it can't save us, right? So God wanted Israel's faithfulness to his law to be, God wanted Israel's faithfulness to be a grateful response to what he had done for them. So that is why he gave them the Ten Commandments, right? As an expression of his love and care for them. So when Israel obeyed God's law, they would be acknowledging that he wanted the best for them. So what I'm going to do now is that instead of saying Israel, I'm going to make it personal. Right? Because we know that even though we might not be physical Israelites by nationality, we are spiritual Israelites, right? So when we obey the law, we are saying, God, you know what's best for me and you know what's good. So by obeying your law, I'm acknowledging that, you are the author of my life, right? So our obedience is an expression of gratitude and a manifestation of the reality of our relationship with God. So Dr. Lex did talk about us renewing our relationship with God, right? And this is one way, by being obedient. That is an action that we can do. We can always come to church and sing, Jesus, I love you more than anything, and all the other songs that we have sung throughout the program. But those are just words, you know? It's just like in a relationship, a guy or a girl, if they like you, they can always say, yeah, I like you. But if they don't do the action towards you, you can be like, I don't really trust your words that are coming out of your mouth, right? So that's the same thing with God. So true obedience comes from the heart as an expression of love. And this love is the distinguishing mark of the presence of the Holy Spirit in the life of the believer. So it goes back to Dr. Lake saying that that is how they know that we are Jesus' disciples, by showing our love, right?
Okay. On the point that you were talking about, how obedience comes out of love, it makes me think about, like, why was the old covenant done away with? And when we go back to the verse, to chapter 8 of Hebrews, and I, like, pretty much just summarized 7 through 13 for myself, and I said that the second covenant was needed to replace the first as fault was found with the people. So that leads me to ask, like, what did the ancestors do? Like, what was so bad? And Hebrews 8 through 19 and verse 9, 8 through 11 and verse 19 says that they were not granted God's rest because of their unbelief. So like their rebellion, their disobedience, their unbelief, like all of that manifested within the people, and they broke their side of the law, that bilateral Mosaic law. And because of that, they were not able to see the promise. So like as a new covenant, we see that the old covenant is obsolete. Like, the new covenant is now unilateral. Like, no matter what we do, like Pastor Lex said, like, Jesus will always love us, and he wants to save us. And even drawing the distinctions, we can see the similarities with the covenants, is that they both tell us that we need a savior. We need a mediator. And in the old covenant, it was the priest. And in the new covenant, is our most high priest, the ultimate priest. And as we look through... go through Hebrews, we see the differences between our ultimate high priest as Jesus and the other priests before, and what makes him the ultimate priest. How the priest before, they had to sacrifice for themselves before they could sacrifice for other people because they had their own sins. But we have Jesus now, who's like, he understands our weaknesses because he's gone through temptation, though he has never sinned. So seeing him and as our mediator and as our priest, and fulfilling this new, like, covenant, I just feel like it's just the manifestation, the biggest act of love. So, yeah, that's just what I had to say about that.
And to continue the point about the old covenant, right, we have to remember that it was not the keeping of the covenant when Israel would go off and they would have all this idolatry and they'd be taken off to foreign nations as captives. That's not when the covenant was replaced. It was replaced when Jesus came. And the reason it was placed when Jesus came is because what was truly broken was their lack of belief in Jesus as the Savior coming to save them from their sins, right? Because we remember, even for Abraham, right, it was through his faith that it was counted to him as righteousness. It was not the perfect keeping of the law, because us on our own cannot keep the law perfectly, right? So then we have the new covenant, where they had the shadow of the things previously through the sanctuary services and so on, but now Jesus has fulfilled that. And he has not done away with the law, but he has fulfilled the law. And he asks us, just like he asked the people of the Old Testament, to have faith in what he is doing and what he has done on earth.
I just got a question. Do you guys really think that God thought that the children of Israel could have kept the covenant? Repeat? Okay, so do you really think that God, when he put out this proposal to them, do you really think that he thought that they could actually keep it? Okay, so do you really think so? I just want to propose something. Could the old covenant, right, could it have been a saving mechanism that God threw out there for the world. Here's why. Well, I don't know if this is all the way, but I think God knew that they weren't going to be able to keep it. Like, I think he knew that. He knew they were going to break it. But he was already, if we go back to Genesis, he was already coming, was he not? So, right? Can we, right? So he's already coming in Genesis 3, right? So he throws out this covenant, not because it's like, yo, here are these rules on stone. They're already keeping it before Exodus 20. He's just like, here's this. But here's some reference points so that y'all could take to the world so that the whole world could be saved. It's not just for y'all. So if you guys kept it, like when I come, everybody else will fall in. Y'all don't keep it, now I got to deal with y'all when I come. You know what I'm saying? And it's like y'all delayed everything because he's already coming, right? So when I think about the old covenant, old and new, it's just in my mind, I think it's just another way of God to like throw out there to the world so that everybody could be saved. And then when he came, it's like, okay, full throttle. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I have to agree with your point because in Hebrews it talks about how this plan was laid out before the foundation of the world. So he knew what was going to happen and he put a plan in place to save us.
The period of trying and not being able to succeed on our own, but when Christ comes, or when Christ came, it's like, okay, well, the law was there. We had seen across the years that this is what happens when the people of God follow the laws of God, right? This is the example of what you could attain, give or take some when they don't follow. But nonetheless, you get the understanding that look, when Christ comes, follow him through love. This is what love is. This is the expression of love. It's not just the law, but the understanding that through grace, everyone can be saved. So this is what was mimicked throughout all the years before Christ came. You can have this as well, but through love. Not you saving yourself through following the law, but the understanding that through love of Christ and the love he demonstrated, you can be saved as well.
Amen. Thank you. Anyone else?
Okay, so as we've heard, the old covenant cannot save us, right? And actually, the new covenant cannot save us either. Both covenants, it's not impossible, but it's only possible with God, but it's impossible with us. So both covenants is supposed to direct our attention to the person who can actually save us, right? So in the new covenant, it was the law, but in the old covenant, it was the Ten Commandments and the law and all of that. And then in the new covenant is where we need to believe and have faith that Jesus can save us. None of those things we can do by ourselves. So it's only possible with Christ. Okay? Anybody else know?
So when the old covenant, when you sinned, you had to bring a lamb and you killed it and you brought it as your sacrifice to pay for your sin, right? So when I'm thinking about the new covenant, it's literally the same. Like, we just, I think because it's not as visceral, we think the effects are less, but you're still like, you're still stabbing Jesus. I'm still stabbing him and putting him on the cross, like, if every time I sin. And when I think about that, it's a little deeper, the new one, because it's your mind goes straight to him. But both covenants, it's so funny how God is. Like, he doesn't change. It's crazy. Both covenants were always about, as she was so eloquently saying, that it's always about what can save me, like what the other thing, like it's never like about me. So like, how do we use that thinking, like as we go forward? Like, how can we really move in that? Because it's so easy to not, because we can't see like the lamb right now. I think sometimes it's easier to kind of slip up a little bit. Or should our focus not be on slipping up and be on living?
One of the differences between the Old Covenant and the New Covenant was that the Old Covenant was a shadow, and a part of that shadow was the physical Ten Commandments that was given to Moses and were put into the Ark of the Covenant, right? But under the New Covenant, God said he would write his law in our hearts and in our minds, right? And because of that, yeah, it might not be as visceral, right? We might not have the Ark of the Covenant in front of us, right? But if we have this relationship with God, he's going to be able to write his law in our hearts, right? And through constant indwelling of the Holy Spirit, we can start to accomplish what God wants for us. Not because it will save us, but because we, loving God, want this for ourselves, and God wants it for us, right?
Not to be facetious, but did God write it with a pen or pencil? So, no, like, for real. So, like, can you have it and, like, lose it? Or can you, like, you kind of answered it about what keeps you, right, the indwelling? But, like, how do you kind of keep that thing kind of tattooed on there? Oh, get a tattoo, SDAs, oh, no, just kidding, get it. What the rub me out?
So, I'd like to add.
Go ahead.
My name is Denise. I'd like to add to that. So, in seeing that, the children of Israel was in bondage for so long, it's like love was obsolete to them. So when God heard their cry, they cried out, like, you know, God, where are you? I know that you're there. I've heard about you from our father Abraham. So where are you? So when God came and showed them this love, they didn't even understand what he was saying. So he took them out of bondage, took them across over to the promised land, parted the Red Sea and all, showed them that, listen, I love you. I love you so much that you don't have to fear this man Pharaoh anymore. You don't have to fear. I am your God. But they didn't receive that. You see, so because they didn't receive that, they wandered, right? And when they wandered, the elders died, and then the young folks like you all were still living, right? And you all were able to see the promised land, right? So then it's like it still wasn't registered. Something was missing. So when the Lord realized something was missing, it had to do with the heart. It wasn't being grasped in the heart. Yes, the Ten Commandments was made, but it still was not being grasped into the heart. So what did he do? When he looked on man and he realized, hey, you know what? They're multiplying. They're being fruitful, right? They're having children. And look at the love they're showing their children. And they don't even realize that what they're showing their children is love. So what did he do? He sent his son, his only begotten son, to show us, listen, this is what I'm saying. This is what I'm trying to tell you guys. This is love. Don't only show it to your children, but show it to your neighbors. Show it to, you know, those who are persecuting you. You know, and from, if we really look at it, the Lord has been showing us this from creation. Look, I created man out of my own image, out of my own likeness. And so I created man, I created woman. Okay? And that was the first covenant. The second covenant would be Jesus, right? Because he sent his only begotten son. And how do you come into that covenant? Right? Through what? The communion, right? For by communion, and this is one of the things that he showed the 12 disciples, right? So do this in remembrance of me, right? So you'd always keep my covenant, right? So what do we show each other or show someone who does not know Christ and has come to receive Christ? We show him, listen, this is the covenant that we follow, right? And showing God, listen, I remember, I saw the things that you did to our forefathers. I remember these things, and I want to come into that covenant too. One of the first covenants that we also have to look at is marriage, right? That is also a covenant, and in a marriage without love, the marriage cannot stand. It will not. So the Lord has shown us love in so many different ways. You know, it's just for us to really see it and say, hey, wait a minute. It's been there all along. You know, that's all I have to say.
Just to answer your question, I think what we have to realize is what was the underlying, you know, we're saying for redemption or saving, but the real underlying reason why both covenants exist is for God to dwell among us. And when you read it in Exodus, and he's like, you know how he gives that long list to build that tabernacle. The reason he stayed, he was just like, I just want to dwell among my people. When the people ask God, talk to us, show us. Moses, tell God that we want to hear the laws and what you're telling him to us face to face. And then God gave them what? Instructions. How to keep yourself holy for the next 3 days so that you are able to dwell in my presence. And that if we take that outlook and apply it to the laws, it wouldn't be that far removed from the new covenant. The new covenant is just like an upgrade. We went from iPhone 1 to whatever iPhone is out right now. And it's just an upgrade and just letting you know how we are to dwell in the presence of God. And you want to keep the law of God in your heart, remain dwelling in his presence. Whether you abide by his commandments, his laws, or you are going down in communion or baptism or whatever case it is, every single part of it is a step closer to not only his plan of redemption, but the ultimate goal of why we're going to heaven, to dwell in eternity in his presence.
Thank you. And we have our last audience.
Yeah, it's also to like part of the question that you asked, whether it's like written in pen, pencil, tattoo, I don't see it as like that. I see it more as a muscle, and it's something we have to keep working at. And you know, if you're used to working out and you take a break for a year, you're gonna feel it next time you work out. So it's something that like, it's not, oh, I have it, so I don't have to worry about it. I don't have to come back to it ever again. It's tattooed on myself, so I'll always wear it. No, it's something that daily we have to practice, and we have to like intentionally do. It's something that we have to make part of our day, part of our routine, part of ourselves. It has to become part of our character trait, that, you know, so that when others see us, they'll know, oh, okay, that is not only a child of God, but that's someone who knows God. Because we're all children of God, but do you know him? Do you know who your father is? Can I see him when I look at you? And so it's not about like, you know, oh, you know, I got baptized, so I'm good now. I don't have to worry about anything else. Or I've read my Bible, so I know it's in my mind. Our memories fade all the time. Like, we forget to do stuff. Our natural instincts take over all the time. So that following his law, his covenant, all of that, being following what God told us to do, and even
practicing love, that has to be something we do over and over and over again. It's not something that's one and done, or I've got this, so I'm good, I don't have to worry about it. It's something that has to be in our hearts, so as long as our hearts are beating, we're practicing that, we're following that, we're making the steps, and even when we fail, we know that it's not, I fail, and this is it, I'm done. I fail, and I can get back up again and keep practicing and keep practicing.
Amen. Thank you.
Can I ask Okay, yeah, I just wanted to piggyback off of that because that's the first thing that came to my mind was that we keep talking about the law being written in the hearts, but he said I would put it in the minds of the people and write it in their hearts. So I feel like it should be, it's going to be a conscious effort for us to be able to like know Jesus for who he truly is. And sometimes he feels intangible because of we don't really know him. And there's a lot of complexity, and Jesus is multifaceted. Even if you like dive into the whole Trinity, all of that, there's a lot going on. So when he says he puts it in our heart, yeah, cool. He does that, but he also places it in our mind. So we have to exercise that and make sure that we're learning and trying to know God for who he truly is, or else we'll lose sight of who he is, just like the Israelites did. And we know what happened then. So yeah.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you, everyone who participated. To wrap up, just to say that in the Bible, if you look in Jeremiah 3:15 or Deuteronomy 29:4, the heart refers to the mind. So the organ of memory and understanding, especially when it comes down to conscious decision. And as the lady said over there, in order to build our muscle memory, like it's exercise, I would say one of the best ways is to read the Bible, spend time in his word, because there is where we see the example of Israel. We see people who followed God's law. We see people who didn't, and we can compare and contrast, right? And the most important thing for us to take away is that Jesus is our mediator. Right now, he is in the heavenly sanctuary between God and us. He's the bridge to, you wanted to read? Okay, he's wanted to read something. Go ahead.
Because you're going to say it, so I'm just going to read it. Okay. Sometimes the lesson just says it in a way that you don't need to change it. So it's in Tuesday's lesson. It says the Greek term mesites or mediator derives from mesos and denotes the one who walks or stands in the middle. It was a technical term that referred to a person who fulfilled one or more of the following functions. One, an arbiter between two parties. Two, a negotiator or business broker. Three, a witness in the legal sense of the word. Or four, one who stands as surety and thus guarantees the execution of agreement. So it can mean four things, right, in the Greek. The English term mediator is too narrow, a translation for mitzvah in the Hebrews, because it focuses only on the first two or three uses of the term. So in other words, somebody's dealing between two parties. And it says, Jesus is not conceived as mediator in the sense that he settles a dispute between the Father and humans, or as a peacemaker who reconciles parties in this disaffection, or as a witness who certifies the existence of a contract or its satisfaction. Instead, as Hebrews explains, Jesus is the guarantor or surety of the new covenant. In Hebrews, the term mediator is equivalent to guarantor. He guarantees the new covenant promises will be fulfilled. And I know some of y'all couldn't get that lease without a guarantor, so that's the end.
Okay, guys, so know God, get to know him, get to love him, and we will, when you start loving him here and you start building that relationship here, heaven will just be a continuation. So if you don't start it here, where are you going? Okay? Thank you for joining us. I hope you enjoyed our program. And now we're going to end and go for lunch. So see you all in the back.
All right, well, there you have it. It seems we have a unanimous decision that love indeed wins. Next time we come up against situations that cause us to forget the importance of loving our neighbors, please, please remember the words of 1 Corinthians 13:4-7. God bless, and thanks for tuning in at MOH. Thank you.
There's a list of my long of all my sins, of everything that I've done wrong. I'm so ashamed. There's nowhere left for me to hide. This is the day I must answer for my life. My fate is in the judge's hands. But then he turns to me and says, I know you, I love you, I gave my life to save you. Love paid the price for mercy. My verdict, not guilty. How can it be? I can't begin to comprehend what kind of grace would take the place of all. Tears well as I look at that cross, 'cause it should have been me. My fate is in the nail-scarred hands. He stretched them out for me. With everything I am, I praise you. I'm grateful for the words you heard me say. I know you. I love you. I gave my life.
So, today we witness attorneys fight for the love they believe their clients deserve. As John 3, verse 16 states, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him may not perish, but have life everlasting. This is a constant reminder of God's love. A constant reminder of God's love for us. As we go through our weeks, let us remember that Jesus is our mediator, pleading our cases before God, that we may reap the benefits of that life. Have a blessed Sabbath. With that being said, I'm going to ask everyone to please stand up as I'm going to pray us out. Dear Lord Father God, thank you for allowing us to be here in your house, in your presence today, learning all about the love that you want us to exude, the love that you want us to be. Lord Father God, as we go about our daily lives, help us remember this lesson about what love is and what love isn't. As we leave, I just ask that you allow us to just stay. As we leave today, I just pray that you allow us to leave not the same way that we came in, so that we may be able to continue to deepen our relationship with you. Continue to be with us continue to be with all of us from now until you return. In Jesus' name, I pray, amen.